بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن شاء الله هنبدأ نكمل الجزء الثاني من الأكاونتنج ميجرمنت اللي كنا بدأناه آخر محاضرة، وكنا بنتكلم فيه على الهستيريكال كوست. إن شاء الله بقى هنكمل النهاردة ونبدأ بالكرنت كوست. الكرنت كوست is the cost that would be required to replace an assets in the current period. This derivation would include the cost of manufacturing a product with the work methods, material, and specification currently in use. The concept is used to generate financial statements that are comparable across multiple reporting periods. Current cost accounting attempts to provide more realistic book values than historical cost, which we discussed before, by valuing the assets at current market buying prices. It takes into account both time value of money and also the inflation. It is more complex than the traditional accounting, which is the historical cost accounting, and it has created controversy about what adjustments are appropriate. Unlike historical cost accounting, which we discussed before, there is no need for inventory cost flow assumption, such as last in, first out, and weighted average, and so on. The business profit in current cost accounting shows how the entity has gained in financial terms the increase in cost of its resources, which is ignored by historical cost accounting. Differentiating operating profit from holding gains and losses has claimed to enhance the usefulness of information being provided by current cost accounting. Holding gains are different from trading income, as they are due to market-wide movements which are beyond the control of the management. Therefore, current cost accounting does not reward managers for profit from holding gains and losses, which isn't an actual profit and also gives useful information to investors. Supporters of current cost accounting are convinced that it provides more useful information than conventional accounting, but still they do not agree on all issues. There is one group who believe in the financial capital concept, in which the holding gains is included in the profit, and the other group is those who believe in the physical capital concept. يعني لازم نفرق بين مفهوم المحافظة على رأس المال المالي ورأس المال المادي. Under physical capital concept, اللي هو مفهوم المحافظة على رأس المال المادي, holding gains and losses are not included in the profit and are supported by the theory of optimal resources usage that uses current cost as a measure of input opportunity costs. That's why we have some criticism of current cost accounting, such as what? Measurement errors. We have reduced the usefulness of current cost and replacement cost data. Replacement cost valuation of plants and equipment, for example, often include the cost of technological advances, and often these advances would reduce operating cost below the level reporting by historical costs. As a result, when replacement cost depreciation is substituted for historical cost depreciation, the cost of doing business includes the high capital cost of the advanced technology as well as the high operating cost of the older technology in use, which creates measurement errors. The supporter of historical cost accounting criticized current cost accounting because it violates the traditional revenue recognition principle by recognizing increases in the value of the assets, both current and non-current, before they are sold. Which is unusual. This is irrelevant, as changes in the market price do not mean anything until the assets are sold. A non-current asset isn't more valuable to a business just because its current cost has increased. Also, another problem is the subjectivity of determining the amount of the increase in cost. There are some non-current assets that do not have a second-hand market because it was specifically built or made for that business only, which means there is no identical market for such assets. So how can we come up with the prices? So the basis of determining the current cost must be the new assets expected to replace the old one, but they are not identical. That's why we have this problem. Current cost accounting also involves a mathematical problem of additivity, which means we added some figures in different time. This is because the figures generated from current cost accounting aren't of the same nature because it involves a variety of measurement models. So how can we add it all together? And we came up with the total asset. The market-to-market practice is known as the fair value accounting, whereby certain assets are recorded at their market value. This means that when the market moves, the value of an asset as reported in the balance sheet may go up or down according to the market price. So the deviation of the market-to-market accounting from the historical cost principle is actually helpful to report on held-for-sale assets. That's it. An asset's market value can be used to predict future cash flow from potential sales. A common example of market-to-market assets would be marketable securities held for trading purposes. As the market swings, securities are marked upward or downward to reflect their true value under a given market conditions. And that's why we have to consider the current prices. The current market prices for marketable security usually at the end of the year or every time you have to prepare your financial statements to reflect their current value at the time. Now we can move to what we call it net realizable value. Net realizable value is the derivation of the estimated selling price of goods minus some deduction, like selling expense, for example, like freight out cost, advertising, and so on. The derivation is used in the determination of the lower of cost or market for on-hand inventory items. And this is one of the methods which is very common to evaluate your ending inventory. The deduction from the estimated selling price are any reasonable predictable cost of 1. Completing the inventory, 2. Transporting the inventory, 3. Disposing of the inventory. So we have to consider the cost for all these and subtract it from the market price so we can keep up with the net realizable value, which is sometimes we call it the X factory, which means subtract all the expenses from the market price until we get the price at the gate of the your company, or the factory, for example. There is an ongoing need to examine the value of inventory to see if it's recorded. Cost should be reduced due to the negative impact of such factors as damage, for example, spoilage, obsolescence, and reduced demand from customers. The further writing down inventory prevents a business from carrying forward any losses for recognition in a future period. Thus, the use of net realizable value is a way to enforce the conservative recording of inventory as its value. And that's usually we use it as a conservatism in accounting. Follow these steps to determine the net realizable value of inventory items. We have to determine the market value of the inventory items, summarize all costs associated with the completing and selling the assets, such as final production, testing, and preparation costs. Then subtract the selling cost from the market value to arrive at the net realizable value. Thus, the formula for net realizable value would be inventory market value minus the cost to complete and sell the goods, which means, as we mentioned, X factory. Net realizable value can also refer to aggregate total of the ending balance in the trade accounts receivable accounts and the offsetting of the allowance for doubtful accounts. So if we subtract the ending balance of the account receivable minus the expected amount for the doubtful accounts at the same time, this would be the net realizable value for the account receivable. This net amount represents the amount of cash that the management expects to realize once it collects all outstanding accounts receivable. So the concept of net realizable value is in two major categories of business bookkeeping: inventories and accounts receivable. Both are classified as current assets, meaning they are assets that a company expects to convert into cash within the next year by selling items out of its inventory and by collecting money owed by its customers. Net realizable value comes into the picture because under generally accepted accounting principle GAAP, businesses must report their inventory at the lower of cost or market, and their accounts receivable should be net of the allowance for doubtful accounts. These rules acknowledge the reality that an asset sometimes is worth as much as it appears on paper. Let us have this exercise to see what we mean by the net realizable value. And this exercise is on the account receivable. On December 31st, year 2020, the balance sheet of the Parun company had accounts receivable of $400,000, and the credit allowance should be in the allowance for doubtful accounts of $32,000. During year 2021, for example, the following transactions occurred. We have sales on accounts of $1,500,000. We have sales return and allowances for $50,000, and you have collection from the customers $1,250,000, and we have accounts written off of $35,000. Previously written off accounts of $4,000 were collected. So the question is, compute net realizable value of accounts receivable on December 31st, year 2021, if the estimated doubtful accounts is 10% of the accounts receivable at that time. To figure that, have this table. We have the beginning balance of the account receivable, and also we have the beginning balance of the allowance for doubtful accounts. So we have net realizable value. The beginning balance of account receivable is 400,000, and the beginning balance of the allowance for doubtful accounts is 32,000, so the difference will be the net realizable value, which is $368,000. And remember, this allowance usually we have to make adjusting entry at the end of the year to expect how much will be the uncollectible accounts next year. During this year, what happens? We have a credit sales of $1,500,000, so the balance of the accounts receivable should be 1,900,000. But we have sales return and collection, so we have to subtract them from the balance. So now we have accounts receivable of 600. What happens if we have accounts written off because it is uncollectible of 35,000? So the allowance should be covered, this allowance, I mean this written off accounts. So we subtract from the account receivable and also we subtract it from the allowance. But remember, the allowance, this is the estimated value, not the exact one. It may be higher, it may be lower. But now the balance of the account receivable is 565, but we have a debit balance in the allowance of 3,000. Some of the accounts which is previously written off now is collected. So what happens? We have to return it back to the allowance by $4,000. So now we have the allowance of 1,000, which is credit balance. At the end of the year, we have accounts receivable of 565,000. But the estimated uncollectible accounts for next year is 10% of the account receivable, which means 565,000 times 10% will come up with 5,650. But we have already 1,000, so we will need only the difference. If, remember, if the allowance was negative balance, which means debit, that's high, debit accounts, so we have to add it together. But now we need only the difference. So now, by the end of the year, we have accounts receivable of 565,000, and the allowance will be 5,650, which is 10% of this one. So we have net realizable value at the end of the year will be 559,350. Let us move to the lower of cost or market, which is net realizable value for the inventory. When the value of the inventory is lower than its cost, somebody must write it down, the inventory, to its market, lower of cost or market, or its net realizable value. Net realizable value in this time will be the amount that a company expects to realize, which is received from the sale of the inventory. This is what we call an example of conservatism. Such as we have these days, the mobile, for example. Every time we have a new version of the mobile, what will happen to the old one? Its price will reduce. So what we have to do for this one? When we try to evaluate the ending inventory of mobiles, for example, we have to take the lower, which is lower of its cost and its market. Now maybe its market will be lower than its cost because we have a new version. So that we have to adjust it to the these methods to calculate the net realizable value. Let us take this exercise to see what we mean by that. Assume that this Kentucky TV has the following lines of merchandise with cost and market value as indicated. They have different items and we have the number of units. They have unit cost and also they have unit market for each items. And the required is to determine the amount of ending inventory by applying the lower of cost or market basis. All we have to do is what? We have to compare the unit cost by the unit market and take the lower of this one. For example, for the first one, we have unit cost is 600, but the market value is what? 550. So we have to take the unit market, which is 550. The second items, the unit cost is 90, while the unit market is 104. So we have to take 90, which is a lower. For the iPad, which is the last, the third items, we have 50, but the unit market is 48. So we have to take the 48. For the CDs, we have a unit cost of 5, but the unit market is 6, so we have to take 5. If you took these prices, multiply by the so we'll have this ending inventory by applying the lower of cost or market basis will be 155,800. That's according to this method. Remember, the net realizable value is an essential measure in inventory accounting under GAAP and also and the International Financial Reporting Standards efforts. The calculation of net realizable value is critical because it prevents the overstatement of the asset's valuation. Now, let us move to another basis for calculating the amount of the asset, which is the present value. The present value, also known as discounted value, is a financial calculation that measures the worth of a future amount of money or stream of payments in today's dollars, adjusted for interest and inflation. In other words, it compares the buying power of one future dollar to purchasing power of one today, which means it will take the time value of money in its consideration. It is an indication of whether the money an investor receives today can earn a return in the future. Present value is widely used in finance, in the stock valuation, bonds pricing, and financial modeling. And I am sure that you will cover such one in finance course, as we explained it last time in the capital budgeting. It is essential to calculate the present value, in other words, to calculate the net present values, so we can compare the different alternatives for the investments, and we can decide it based on this one, because we have to consider the time value of money, and that's why. Investors usually calculate the present value of a firm expected cash flow to decide if the stock is worth investing in today, and that's usually use it to estimate how much will be the market price per share, for example, based on the expected cash flows. The firm's expected cash flows are discounted at a discount rate, which sometimes with ROI, return on investment, and sometimes we took the, what we call it, the WACC, which is weighted average cost of capital. This discount rate is, that is actually the expected return. The discount rate is inversely correlated to the future cash flows. The higher the discount rate, the lower the present value of the expected cash flows. The concept of present value is critical in many financial applications, such as the valuation of long-term notes receivable, long-term liabilities, bonds payable, pension obligation, decision to invest in fixed assets, which is capital budgeting, and whether to purchase one type of investments over another. In the latter case, present value provides a common basis for comparing different types of investments. The essential component of the present value calculation is the interest rate to use for discount purposes, while the market rate of the interest is the most theoretically correct. It can also be adjusted up or down to account for perceived risk of the underlying cash flow. For example, if the cash flows were perceived to be highly difficult, a higher discount rate might be justified, which would result in a smaller present value. As we mentioned before, the higher the rate, the lower the present value will be. These are the formula usually to calculate the present value for one amount. It will be the present value, it will be the expected cash flow divided by 1 plus the interest rate to the power n, which is the number of period. But if we have annuity, which is have different value, and we'd like to calculate the present value, so we have to consider the annuity, which is the present value in this case will equal to the expected cash flow times 1 minus 1 over 1 plus interest rate to the power n, all of them on the interest rate. So we can keep up. And usually we have tables already for that, you can use it for annuity and also for $1. It's available, and also we can bring it to you anyway. Now, we have another problem, which is the property, plant, and equipment. This is one of the major area. We have a lot of problems to estimate or to figure how much will be the amount of property, plant, and equipment should be disclosed in the balance sheet, for example. Plant assets usually are sources that have three characteristics. One, they have a physical substance, which is a definite size and shape. You can see it and touch it. Two, they are used in the operation of a business, not for sale. They are not intended for sale to customers. These assets are expected to provide service to the company for a number of years, except for land. Why land? Because land usually has unlimited life. Plant assets decline in service potential over their useful life. And the major classes of plant assets should be in this order. First, we have land, then we have land improvements, then we have buildings, then we have equipment, then machines, then means of transportation, all of them. Then we have the furniture and office equipment, and that's it. Usually the plant assets with the usually has three stages. We can figure this one in the following graph. First stage, which is the acquisition, when we acquire plant assets. So the problem for this stage is, how could we calculate the cost of the plant assets? So this is the first problem. Then we move to another one, which is during the estimated useful life of the assets, we have to consider the depreciation. This depreciation depends on the cost, how much, and the estimated useful life, how many years, for example, will be, and also the expected salvage value at the end of its useful life. And the last and the third stage, which is the disposition of the plant assets. How can we dispose this plant assets at the end of its useful life? So the first problem, which is how to determine the cost of the plant assets. Usually the cost consists of all expenditures necessary to acquire the assets and to make it ready for use. So the cost includes the purchase price, the freight cost paid by the purchaser, and any installation cost. Once the cost is established, the company uses the amount as the basis of accounting for the plant assets over its useful life. That's what we mean by the total cost. Then the second stage is to calculate for the depreciation, which is the method of cost allocation. Depreciation is the account process of allocating the cost of tangible assets to expense in a systematic and rational manner to those periods expected to benefit from the use of the assets. Allocating cost of long-lived assets, we have three groups in assets. Fixed assets, we use depreciation expense. For intangible assets, we use amortization expense. For mineral or natural resources, we use depletion expense. Depreciation, as we mentioned, is the process of allocating to expense the cost of plant assets over its useful life in a rational, systematic manner. So, what are the factors in computing depreciation? We have to know three factors. First, the cost, as we mentioned before. Second, how many years is the useful life of such assets, and of course how much will be the salvage value, expected salvage value at the end of its useful life. These factors involved in depreciation process will be the estimation of service life. Service life often differs from physical life. Companies retire assets for two reasons. First one, physical factors, which is causality of expiration of physical life. It ended. The second one, which is the economic factors, may be these assets became inadequacy or suppressions or obsolescence. All these factors now is represent the economic factors, which means we have to get rid of, or we have to consider for depreciation for such factors. The second problem, which is the special depreciation issues. How should companies compute the depreciation for partial periods? Not necessarily to purchase all these plant assets at the beginning of the year. It depends. Any time you can purchase or acquire plant assets. Does depreciation provide for the replacement of assets? Did you consider that? And also, how should companies handle revision in depreciation rate if it happens and you change the depreciation rate, which is based on the its estimated useful life, as we explained it just in a moment. For how should companies compute for depreciation for partial periods, usually companies determine the depreciation expense for the full year and then prorate this depreciation expense between the two periods involved. For example, suppose we purchase this plant assets, let us say on the beginning of April, for example. So for the first year we have from April until the end of the year, which is December 31st, we have 9 months. So we have to consider depreciation for this period, only for the first one. And so on. This process should continue throughout the useful life of the assets. What are the depreciation methods we can use? Depreciation is computed using one of the following methods. We have the straight line method, which is the most common methods, and even the tax agents usually use it. And also we have units of activity methods, because some assets do not based on the estimated useful life in terms of years. They use units of activity. Declining balance. And we'll talk about all these methods just in a moment. Each method is acceptable under GAAP. But once a company chooses methods, it should apply it consistently over the useful life of the assets. Depreciation affects the balance sheet through accumulated depreciation and also affects the income statement through the depreciation expense. And that's why every time we calculate for depreciation, we have to record it by debiting depreciation expense and credit accumulated depreciation. Let's take this exercise. On January 1st, year 2020, our company purchased a new equipment for $50,000. The following data were available. They have expected salvage value, $5,000. They have the estimated useful life in years, which is 5 years. And also they have an estimated useful life in hours, $100,000. And the requirement is to compute the depreciation and accumulated depreciation under each of the following methods. Straight line methods, then units of activity methods, and finally declining balance methods. For the straight line methods, under the straight line method, the company expends the same amount of depreciation for each year of the asset's useful life. The annual depreciation expense usually is calculated according to the following equation, which is cost minus salvage value divided by the estimated useful life. And also, we can calculate the depreciation rate, which is 100% divided by the estimated useful life. Most of the accounting usually use this one. Instead of dividing by the estimated useful life, they can multiply the difference between cost and salvage value by the depreciation rate. Most of accountants do that. And the book value of assets is equal to the cost, of course, minus the accumulated depreciation. So for the straight line methods, the annual depreciation will be 50,000 minus 5,000 divided by 5 years will be 9,000. And the depreciation rate will be 100% divided by 5 will be 20%. And the depreciation expense will be 50 minus 5,000 and 20% will also be 9,000. And this is a table for depreciation for all over the useful life of the assets. The cost will be 50,000. The depreciation rate as we computed early is 20%. And the annual depreciation will be 9,000 every year. But the accumulated depreciation will increase every time by 9,000. And of course, the book value will decrease, which is equal to the cost minus the accumulated depreciation. And after 5 years, the book value will be 5,000, which is equal to the salvage value. And the book value is equal to the accumulated depreciation. For the units of activity methods, we have sometimes such some assets do not use the estimated useful life in terms of years. Under the units of activity method, useful life is expressed in terms of the total units of production or use expected from the assets rather than a time period. Units of production may be in terms of hours, kilometers, miles, and number of cars. For example, how could we calculate the estimated useful life for airplane, for example? Not in terms of years, it would be in terms of flying hours. For a copier, for example, number of copies. Some of the truck, usually we use it kilometers or miles. See? So we don't have to use the estimated useful life in years. It should be in terms of these units. So we have to calculate the depreciation per unit. How? Will be the cost minus the salvage value divided by the estimated total units of activity. So we have the depreciation per unit. So every time we have number of units in every year, we can multiply. So the annual depreciation expense will be the units of activity during the year times the depreciation per unit. In our example here, depreciation per hours, because the figure, the estimated useful life in terms of hour of 100,000 hours. So 50 minus 5,000 divided by 100,000 will have 45 cents per hour. So how many hours every year we multiply? But the total hour, remember, will be only 100,000. And that's according to this table. Units of activity for the first year, 15,000, second year, 20,000. Third year, 30,000, then fourth year, 25,000, then the last year should be 10,000. Why? Because the total will be 100,000 times the depreciation rate, which is 45 cents. We came up with the annual depreciation based on the number of units and the accumulated depreciation added exactly like the straight line methods. And the book value is still the cost minus the accumulated depreciation. Finally, the declining balance methods. The declining balance method produces a decreasing annual depreciation expense over the asset's useful life. This method is based on when the asset is new, so the expense for maintenance will be lower. So, if we added this together, all over the estimated useful life for the assets, we will have something like a straight line for both of them. So the depreciation is computed by multiplying the book value at the beginning of the year by the declining balance depreciation rate. And the depreciation rate remains constant from year to year, but the book value declining each year. This method ignores the salvage value in determining the amount to which the decline balance rate is applied. And the depreciation will stop when the asset's book value equal expected salvage value. So the declining balance, first we have to calculate the declining balance rate, which is equal to the straight line rate times 2. And that's why we call it double declining balance. So it will be 20% times 2 will be 40%. And that's why this method is called double declining balance, DDB. And that's it. So we took the book value, which is beginning book value 50, times the rate, which is 40. So we came up with the annual depreciation for the first year 20, and of course the accumulated depreciation will be 20. But the ending book value will be 50 minus 20 will be 30,000, which will be the beginning for the second year, times 40. So the depreciation will be 12,000. So we have accumulated depreciation together, 12,000 plus 20 will be 32,000. And the book value will be 18,000 for the second year. It will be the beginning for the third year, 18,000 times 40%. So we came up with the annual depreciation 7,200. So the accumulated depreciation will be 39,200, and the ending book value will be 10,800 for the third year. It will be the beginning of the fourth year, 10,800 times 40%. It will be 4,320. So we have accumulated depreciation of 43,520. So the ending book value for the fourth year will be 6,480. So this is, will be the beginning of the fifth year. If we multiply this one by 40 and add it to the accumulated depreciation, the book value will be less than 5,000. And that's the condition for this one, as we mentioned before, the book value not to be less than the salvage value. So we have to adjust the annual depreciation for the last year by taking the difference between the beginning book value and the ending book value, which is supposed to be the salvage value. That's why we came up with annual depreciation of 1,480, and the accumulated depreciation would be 45,000. So the last step, which is the plant asset disposal. Plant assets could be disposed in three ways. We can retirement, because now it is useless, or we can sell it, and sometimes you can exchange it. At the time of disposal, the company record depreciation for the fraction of the year to the date of the disposal, from the last year and the date of depreciation of the disposal. The book value is then eliminated by two entries. First, we have to debit the accumulated depreciation for the total depreciation to date, and also we have to credit the assets account for the cost of the assets. If we retire of the plant assets and we still have some book value, if the company retired plant assets before it is fully depreciated and no cash is received for scrapped or salvage value, so we have a loss on disposal of plant assets will occur. So the entry will be as follows. It will be debit accumulated depreciation, credit equipment, and the difference will be loss on the disposal. And this is for the previous example which we discussed for depreciation methods. Companies report a loss on disposal in the other expense and losses section of the income statement. But if we can sell the plant assets in disposal by sale, so the company compared the book value of the assets with the proceeds received from the sale. So we have two possible cases. First, if the proceeds of the sale exceed the book value of the plant assets, so we have a gain on disposal occurs. But if the proceeds of the sale are less than book value of the plant asset sold, so we have a loss on disposal. Now let us have an exercise to see how can we figure for the sale of plant assets. Regarding the information exercise 5, suppose the equipment were sold on ending of its useful life at 1, 8,000, 2, 4,000. And remember, the salvage value at the end of the assets was 5,000. So if we sold it at 8,000, what does it mean? It means we will have a gain on the disposal of the assets. But if we sold it at 4,000, we have a loss on disposal. And the requirement is to prepare the necessary entry to record the sale of the equipment. The first one, as I mentioned right now, we have a gain on disposal. Why? Because the book value was 5,000 and we sold it at 8,000. So we debit cash for 8,000, debit accumulated depreciation for equipment for 45,000, but credit equipment for 50, and we have a gain on disposal of 3,000. But if we sold it at 4,000, so we have loss on disposal. So debit cash by 4,000, debit accumulated depreciation for equipment by 45, but we have a loss on disposal 1,000, and the equipment will be 50,000. ودي كانت آخر حاجة في محاضرتنا النهاردة، بس لسه طبعا في حاجات في المقرر، بس احنا قلنا نخلص كده معاكم، ومفيش غير اننا يعني نقول وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأدعو لكم جميعا بالتوفيق وبالصحة والسعادة، ونراكم جميعا قريبا على خير إن شاء الله، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.